I've been doing a little series. If you've been here for a while, you may have. This is the, I think, the third one in a series on being successful. And I plan on continuing that, and I am going to continue that, but I'm going to talk about something I didn't plan to talk about. Something I never had a part of this series before, but the Lord has kind of interjected it, so we're just going to go with it. But just a real quick review for the sake of those that maybe weren't here. I've started this series. It's called Success, What It Is and How to Get It. And we've talked about really just practical keys, practical steps we can take to help us be successful. And my main objective with this was to kind of combat the idea that God does not want his people to be successful. There's like a theme, I think, in the church that many people have had. You know, well, we're just barely getting by, and that's a good sign that we're a Christian. And I don't believe that's what God intends for us. Now, by success, I also don't mean that God intends for all of us to be multimillionaires with yachts and three or four homes, and which is, hey, that's nothing wrong. There's nothing wrong with those kind of things. If that's something God has opened the door for in your life, you keep those things. But what I believe success is a three-part thing. Number one, it's knowing him. If we don't know him, it doesn't matter what else happens, we have failed. When it's all said and done, if we don't know him, it doesn't matter what we did. And number two is becoming like him. Because we can know him, which we have to do, and that, you know, is a wonderful thing, gets us into eternal life. But if we're not like him in the earth, I believe we're going to fall short in the third part, which is accomplishing what it is that he's put on our lives to accomplish. I think it was Jonathan who prayed this morning about the destiny and purpose that's on this church and on each individual in this church. And I believe that. I believe that really is true. And the third part of being successful is that we walk out and fulfill that specific purpose and destiny he has for us. And today, what I want to talk about is something I think that's tied into all three of those things. And at first, I didn't think so, and I began to kind of resist the Lord when he told me, I felt like he showed me to kind of go this direction. I thought, that's not what I want to do. I've already got something figured out, and that's just going to mess me up. And so then as I began to be obedient the best I could and put this together, I begin to see how it does tie in with all three aspects of being successful. And so we've talked about relationships, talked about habits, and talked about letting the Lord lead us through seasons of change. And this morning, I want to use what has become a bad word in some churches, and that is the word yielding. That has become a bad word in some churches. I don't think our culture understands that as well as other cultures do, and our generation, I think, struggles to understand that as maybe as well as previous generations have. But there is something about yielding, I believe, we have to understand if we're going to truly be successful. Now, immediately I can just feel it. When I said that word yielding, some of you thought, oh, good, here we go. He's going to tell me I can't have what I want to have. And that's not what this is about. That's not what this is about at all. And again, I mentioned before, you know, my goal is to be practical. And I believe this is practical. And let me start with a verse. And this is going to further confirm to you that you can't have what you want. I'm just kidding. But let me just, if you guys just kind of hang in here, I believe this will end up being very encouraging. Hopefully shed a different light on the idea of yielding than many of us have had before. Because really, I think hopefully shed a different light on the Lord than many of us maybe have seen before. But Luke chapter 14, and again, I have failed this morning. I did not get my verses turned in to these guys, and I'm sorry. And actually, I'm supposed to be doing this myself. They've given me the means to log in, do it myself, and I haven't done that, and I'm sorry. So if you guys want to turn there, you can, or if you want to just listen, you can do that as well. Most of the verses I plan to cover today are pretty common verses anyway. But Luke chapter 14, verse 27. This is Jesus talking. He's talking about discipleship. Here's what he says. I'm reading the New American Standard. I heard last week, I wasn't here, that Dan picked on me a little bit, though. And something to the effect that he hopes I get delivered of, you know, whatever it was. He wasn't listening to himself. He insults me so often, he loses track of all that he says. So, you know. But I have the New American Standard today. I know Dan likes to use NIV. They're pretty similar. But the New American Standard reads this way. Luke 14, 27. Jesus is talking and says, whoever does not carry his own cross and come after me cannot be my disciple. And that's the second time in about five chapters Jesus said that. He said it back in Luke 9 as well. And we could have read either one, but I picked Luke 14. Whoever does not carry his own cross and come after me cannot be my disciple. I'll come over here because I leave you guys out sometimes. I kind of go over there and look that way. So since it's going to be an uncomfortable topic, I'm going to look at Jenna today. So, you know, but now I'm just picking. But he who does not carry, or he or she does not carry his own cross cannot be my disciples, what Jesus said. Now, I'm not a school teacher. Many of you I know here are. I remember being a student, though. I'd be in school, raise my hand, or someone raise their hand and say, teacher, can I go to the bathroom? And inevitably, the teacher would say, well, I'm sure you can, but that's not what you're supposed to ask me. And you're standing there, if you're a little boy, you're going, I really have to go, you know. And she makes you say it the proper way, may I go to the bathroom? Yes, you may. Now, it's interesting here, Jesus didn't say the word may. Jesus said the word can. And the difference there is, you know, you learn that when you're in school trying to go to the bathroom, is can means ability. May means permission. You know, so teacher, do I have your permission to go to the bathroom? Yes, you do. And I'm not saying, do I possess the physical ability to do this? I'm sure you do. But what Jesus said here, he didn't say, if you don't carry your cross, I'm not going to give you permission to be my disciple. What he said was, if you don't carry your cross, it's just plain not going to work. It is not, it cannot be. It's not that I'm saying no, it's that it cannot work if you don't carry your own cross. So I heard several years ago a good definition of what it means, the word cross. Now we know obviously the cross is an instrument of death. Now Jesus basically was executed. Now he was executed unjustly, but he was executed. And, you know, the cross, which, and you have all heard this before, but it's a pretty piece of jewelry. You know, 2,000 years ago, it was not that at all. And I'm glad that it is now. I'm glad that we embrace the cross that way. And it is a beautiful thing because it has saved us from a life of sin. It saved us from eternity apart from God. So the cross is a beautiful thing. But almost in our culture now, it'd be like wearing a necklace of an electric chair, which none of us would do that. But that is pretty much what that was 2,000 years ago when Jesus was nailed to it. It was an instrument of execution. It was, you have broken the law, and you're going to die for it. And that's what it was. And it was a horrible, torturous way to die. And so Jesus says here, if you don't carry your own cross, you can't come after me and be my disciple. And here's a definition that I heard years ago. Our cross is where our will and God's will cross. It's that point where what we want for ourselves and what he may want for us is different. And again, I'm not here to say you can't have what you want. I'm here to say that if we receive what he has for us, we'll find that all along it's what we really wanted anyway. We'll find true happiness only in the things that he has for us. So I believe that to be truly successful, which again is knowing him, becoming like him, and doing what it is he's called us to do, we've got to be willing to lay down what we want for ourselves and allow him to bring in what he wants for us. And we've gotten away from that and not so much here at Unified, but in the American contemporary culture, many churches, many streams have gotten away from the idea. You know, we're very encouraging, which we should be, and we encourage people, you're going to make it, you're going to succeed, and we should be doing that. But we cannot separate success from the idea of laying down our lives, taking the cross, and receiving what God has for us. Because we're never going to truly be successful if we think that way and behave that way. We've got to lay down our will whenever it conflicts with what his will is. I had to do that when I was putting this message together. I already had a plan. I didn't need this. This is not what I needed. But obviously it is what I needed. And last night I was putting this together. I was up late doing this. And I'm not saying that to score points or anything, but Dan, I was up slaving, pouring over the Bible, putting this together. And when I was finished, everybody was asleep, and I jumped in the shower quietly to not wake up the baby. And in the shower, I didn't start crying, which it beyond me, but I really just had a little breakdown of having this renewed in my heart. Of, you know what, Lord, I don't want anything if it's not what you have for me. I don't want anything in this life, because I find myself sometimes getting distracted by things I want to pursue, I want to go after, and dreams I've got, and we should do that. But guess what? There's also a place of rest we've got to abide in, recognizing that no matter what we want, only he can really give it to us. And there's a place and a time for being proactive and for going after things. It's also a place of recognizing it's not our job to scratch and claw and grind and grab things. Jesus, who had the very nature of God, he was made in the image of God, did not even scratch and claw, try to keep that, Philippians tells us. He laid it down. So there's a place of balance here and a place of rest we've got to rediscover, I believe, it's going to lead to true success. And I mentioned a minute ago, let me read this in Psalm 37. Again, another very common passage, one that most of you probably have memorized. But again, in reality, what we really want, the deepest part of our heart, what we really want is the things He wants for us. And oftentimes we rob ourselves of that by not letting go of what we have. And if we refuse to let go and open our hand of what we've got, we can't receive what He has for us. As long as we're clutching our fist tight to not let go of what we have, we can never receive what He really has for us. Now, Psalm 37, let me read a few verses here, starting in verse 4. This is David talking here, and he says, "Delight yourself in the Lord, and He will give you the desires of your heart." He will give you the desires of your heart. And again, I don't want to get imbalanced and go, well, we just wait for everything. There is a time we go after things. We pursue things. But He brings those things to us. Verse 5 says, "Commit your way to the Lord, trust also in Him, and He will do it." He'll do it. "And He will bring forth your righteousness as the light and your judgment as the noonday. Rest in the Lord and wait patiently for Him. Do not fret because of him who prospers in his way, because of the man who carries out wicked schemes. Cease from anger, forsake wrath. Do not fret. It only leads to evil doing." Do not fret. It only leads to evil doing. George MacDonald said something one time. He was a Scottish minister and author back in the 19th century. And he was very influential in C.S. Lewis's life and Tolkien's life. If it wasn't for MacDonald, we wouldn't have Lord of the Rings, wouldn't have Chronicles of Narnia. So I wouldn't be standing here probably if it wasn't for the influence over the years of George MacDonald. And he said something one time. He said, "Whatever we try to do apart from God will either fail miserably or else it will succeed even more miserably." Think about that. Whatever we try to do apart from God will either fail miserably or else it will succeed even more miserably. And I can look back in my life, and I'm still fairly young. I'm saying that in faith. I'm still fairly young. But when I look back and see doors that God, in His sovereignty, in His wisdom, didn't open for me, if I forced those things open, which I did sometimes, now I regret doing that. Because that is not the best He had for me. It may have been a good thing. It may have been something He even blessed in His mercy. But it was not the best He had for me. When I force and try to plow my way through a door that God has chosen for whatever reason not to open, or not to open yet, maybe one day He will. If I go barreling through it too early, I'm robbing myself of the best, because the good is often the worst enemy of the best. Or I look back and I see that I couldn't get the door open, and now I'm glad, because I can see the door He did lead me to was far better, and I'm far happier than I ever would have been in some place He didn't have for me. And again, the good can be the worst enemy of the best. So there's times when, again, being very practical, we have to lay down what we want. We've got to take up our cross, which again is that place where our will and His will cross. And we got to decide which way we're going to go. Are we going to refuse to let go of what we've got? Are we going to stubbornly hang on to what we want for ourselves when maybe it's not what He wants for us? And some classic examples from the Bible. And here I'm going to take a turn. And this is going to almost, you're going to wonder, what's Mike doing? He just went a whole different direction. And I'm going to. But that's because I believe there's a side to this that we really haven't understood by and large before. Dan probably has, because he knows it all. But a lot of us here have not understood this. So I'm about to kind of change gears. But if you stick with me, it's going to make sense. Now, what I've been saying here, here's some obvious examples of this. The classic example is Abraham. When I've heard this talk before, Abraham had to bring Isaac. Now think about this. Abraham was old. He was older than anybody else in this room. And God had been promising him for a long time, you're going to have a son. And Abraham's a good example of somebody who made it happen in his own strength. and he had Ishmael. And here today, 4,000-ish years later, we still have negative consequences in the world from that decision. God still chose to bless Ishmael because he promised Abraham, I'll bless the seed that you bring forth. But that was not God's plan. That was not God's plan. There in my life have been Ishmaels before that God promised me one thing, and I thought, well, I'm going to take it upon myself to go get this. And I left that place of rest. I left that place of understanding God's going to bring this to me when he's ready. And I created an Ishmael. And what happened in Abraham's life is Ishmael began to battle Isaac. When Isaac came, who was the son of promise, the one that God did intend to bring all along, they battled. And they still battled this day. You still see the generations later, the generations that descended from Ishmael and those that came from Isaac, it's a constant battle. Because Abraham decided not to wait on the Lord, but to go do it himself. And so what he created is not what God intended for him to have. So then when he finally gets Isaac, God says, go kill him. I mean, imagine that. Well, God, now you told me to wait for you. I waited a long, long time. I'm an old man. I don't have another shot at this. You want me to go kill him? But he did. He didn't kill him. Another story. God stepped in. God had a reason that was different than Isaac actually dying. But he had to decide, okay, not my will, but yours. And, of course, Jesus did the same thing in Gethsemane. He was facing the cross. He was hours away from the actual cross. And he said, you know, if there's another way, if you could let this pass from me, but if not, not my will, but your will be done. And thank God he did. Or you and I have been in a world of hurt, literally. So then I thought about David also last night when I was putting this together. David wanted to build God's temple, and God said, no, you can't do that. And what would have happened if he had anyway? God had chosen Solomon to build the temple. You know, so David wanted to do something God hadn't called him to do. Then you have Moses. Moses didn't want to do what God called him to do. Moses, I don't want to go talk to Pharaoh and lead these people. I can't even talk. And God said, you can do it. He didn't want to do what God had for him. He had to choose. Okay, I'm going to say yes to this, although I want to say no to this. He had a cross to take up right there. Now, let's change gears for a second here. Those are obvious examples. I want to give you guys a less obvious example and one that applies to every one of us here this morning. I want to read, and I'm still okay on time here. I want to read in Proverbs chapter 3 and move into a very less obvious example. Proverbs 3, this is a great graduation verse. Going to Christian school, growing up and stuff, we heard this at every graduation. But Proverbs 3, and we'll start in verse 5 and read a little bit here. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Now Solomon here, the wisest man apart from Jesus to ever live, at least in Bible days. He's not as wise as Dan. Trust in the Lord with all your heart, and do not lean on your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge him, and he will make your path straight. Do not be wise in your own eyes. Fear the Lord and turn away from evil. It will be healing to your body and refreshment to your bones. Honor the Lord from your wealth and from the first of all your produce, and so your barns will be filled with plenty, and your vats will overflow with new wine. Let's look at verse 11. All that was good stuff. All that is what we've been talking about so far. Here's where we're going to take a turn here, verse 11. It says, my son, do not reject the discipline of the Lord or loathe his reproof. For whom the Lord loves, he reproves, even as a father the son in whom he delights. So my son, do not reject the discipline of the Lord or loathe his reproof. For whom the Lord loves, he reproves, even a father the son in whom he delights. Now I am, for the first time ever, a father of a son. It's a cool thing. It really is. I had three daughters and love my daughters totally. Don't love my son any more than them. And I thought, you know, when Nicole got pregnant this fourth time, that, you know, we'll probably have another girl because we're pretty good at producing girls. And I would have been totally happy with another girl. I would have been. But nothing could prepare me really for having a son. And I kind of dread that day when I got to pop that bottom for the first time. You know, my three girls, they've all had experience daddy popping their bottom. And I remember when I first spanked Ava. Ava's our oldest, and She was about probably a year old, I guess, or maybe a little older, and I had to pop her hand. And she was just flat out disobeying me and knew what she was doing. And I knew, okay, her will and my will are crossing here. If I don't win this now, I'm going to have a world of hurt when she's 14, 15. I got to get a hold of this girl right now. And it broke my heart to pop her hand. You know, your parents used to tell you, it hurts me worse than it hurts you. My friend, Josh Baldwin, used to tell his dad, well, let me spank you then. I'm the one who needs to get punished here. If that's true, let me turn around, let me spank you. And I'll be getting punished that way. But it broke my heart to spank Ava for the first time. I shouldn't say this, but I couldn't wait to spank Allie for the first time. That little girl, I really mean that. I was waiting. I was counting down the days for her to understand what she was doing. You know, I don't believe you ought to pop a kid's bottom when they don't know what they did. You know, and we don't like discipline for making a mistake. We discipline for defying, you know, and deliberately choosing to go the wrong way. And Allie did that a lot. And Amelia, who was the baby, she's the baby girl, you know, she likes to kind of cute her way out of things. And she's pretty good at that. But I don't like, honestly, having to spank any of them. And I do dread the day when I got to spank Finn. But I do that because I love my kids. And if I didn't love them, I didn't care, then that's fine. Just go whatever way you want to go. It doesn't matter to me what happens to you. But because it does matter to me what happens to them, I step in. And I have to sometimes bring discipline. Well, same way with the Lord. You're like, what does that have to do with carrying our cross? Let me quickly, and kind of close with this because we're running out of time here. Let me quickly summarize one thing, and then we'll close with something else. How's that? You guys thoroughly confused yet? But I shared about spanking my kids for a reason. I'm going to come back to that in a second. I've been spanked by the Lord before. You guys ever been spanked by the Lord? He doesn't do it physically, but there's discipline that comes anyway. But a very common passage of Scripture, again, Matthew chapter 16, verse 26. I'll just quote it for sake of time. But Jesus was talking, and he said, what would it profit a man to gain the whole world and lose his soul? And what would a man give in exchange for his soul? Now, we can spend hours and hours talking about that. And you guys have heard me mention that before. I've discussed this verse here before. Now, we mentioned about our will, or our will and God's will cross. And that oftentimes is the cross we have to carry, we've got to take up. Our will is a part of our soul. Now, for many years, and I would hear that verse talked about, I've heard it sung about, I'll just kind of assume, and I'll hear it talked about, what that means is, what good would it do you to have everything this world has to offer and then go to hell when you die? And that's kind of the way I heard that verse interpreted over the years. And obviously that's true. It wouldn't do you a bit of good to have all the world has to offer and then not get to go to heaven when you die. But I don't believe that's primarily what Jesus was talking about. Because he didn't say, lose your spirit. And I believe he would have if that's primarily what he meant. What would it profit you to have everything the world has to offer and then lose your spirit? But soul is different from our spirit a little bit. Now, our soul is eternal also, but our soul has three parts to it. Our minds, our wills, and our emotions. And our minds are the part of us that say, I know, or I don't know, or I think, I don't think, I believe, I understand, I remember. Stuff like that. That's what our minds say as part of our souls. Our emotions say, I feel or I don't feel. I don't feel like doing that. Or I feel bad, so I'm not going to go that direction. Or I don't feel like that's right. Or I feel sad. I feel angry. I feel jealous. I feel, you know, whatever it is. Those are our emotions. Again, part of our souls. Our will, which is where I want to look at for a second here as we wind this down, that says I want or I don't want. So when the Lord kind of changed my plans about even this message, no, I don't want to cover that. I don't want to talk about yielding. But I'm going to yield and do it anyway because that's a part of our souls. So what I think Jesus meant primarily, because he was talking to his disciples also here, when he said, what would it profit you to gain the whole world, lose your soul? I think he was saying, what good does it do you to have all the world has to offer, but to have your soul, your mind, things you think about, things that you feel and things you want, more wrapped up in this temporary world than it is in eternity? That's what it means, I believe, to lose your soul, is to have your desires and have your wishes and have your thoughts and have what has shaped your thinking patterns and your desires and your feelings more wrapped up in right now than eternity. More wrapped up in what I can do for myself right now than in the kingdom and letting Him bring to me what He wants to bring. So let's take this idea of our wills and take this idea of God's discipline and look together in Genesis chapter 3. I'm going to bring up my kids again. I remember when I first spanked Ava, and again, broke my heart, really did. I hated it. Hated doing that. Because it was tough for her, tough for me, but it was tough for her because I'd always been the one that consoled her when she got hurt, her mommy and I. And now I'm the one that caused the pain in her mind. So what does she do? You know, she popped her hand and she goes and hides her hand from me and wanted to come to me to get consoled, but I'm the one that did it. And that bewilderment and that confusion in her eyes was so hard to look at. You know, so hard for her to see her trying to process, what do I do here? Because he's the one I want to run to, but he's the one that hurt me. So what do I do? Now, you and I aren't kids anymore, but we have that same choice to make sometimes with the Lord. Now, I'm going to summarize this again for sake of time. What's happened here in Genesis chapter 3 is the devil's in the tree of knowledge of good and evil, and God has said, if you guys choose to eat that fruit, you're going to bring death in the world. That fruit is not for you to have. Of course, they made the choice anyway. They had that fruit. They brought death in the world. But then what happened is, immediately following that decision, they looked down and realized they didn't have any clothes on. They were naked. And they had never realized that before, or had never been a problem for them before. But now, for the first time ever in human history, at this point, in whatever time it had been, the short human history, for the first time ever, they made a decision based on what they knew instead of what God's will was for them. From that place, their soul, that place of knowing, wanting, feeling, took a dominant position over their spirit. And look what happened because of it. So they go and take fig leaves and make coverings for themselves. They, in their own strength, tried to cover their nakedness. But also, that was enough, so they went and hid. So then God comes looking for them. And, you know, even this morning I've realized more and more how I've seen this passage before. So here they are. They've made the mistake. They've sinned. They've chosen to eat this fruit that God said, if you do this, it's going to bring death in the world. So don't do it. They did anyway, and they go hide. Well, then here comes God looking for them, and they're hiding. Now, I've always, my whole life, envisioned God coming angry. I've always envisioned that. I've always envisioned Him coming angry looking for them. Because He knew what had happened. You know, he knew the whole story. But, I don't think He was angry. Because when I've had to spank my girls, you know, I've been angry at what happened. But again, I don't like it. And it breaks my heart that I have to do it. So here I am, if I'm an imperfect earthly father, how much more does it break the heart of our heavenly Father, who is perfect, that we're in a mess all of a sudden? I don't think He came angry, ready to spank them. I think He came ready to embrace them and fix the mess. Now, I don't know what would have happened. I don't know if He would have, you know, second chance. Who knows? We're never going to know. But they ran and hid because in their mind, He was coming at them angry. He was coming to get them for what they had done. So they went and hid. When I think what He wanted was them to run to Him instead of running away from Him. I have a pattern in my life when I receive that discipline from the Lord, when He has to discipline me, I run away. I run away. What He wants from me is to run right to Him. He wants to console me. And Amelia, you know, she has no problem running right to me. I'm glad she doesn't. You know, she never has gotten out of that daddy's girl stage. And Ava and Allie, you know, are still daddy's girls also. But Amelia still is right. You know, she has never, and hopefully she never will. She's daddy's girl. and I've had to pop that bottom or whatever, and she'll be crying at the top of her lungs, running right for me, arm straight out. And that's what I want. I want to pick her up and say, you know, I love you. I don't want to have to spank you. I don't want that. But the reason I do is because I do love you. I do care about you. I don't want you to go that way, because I know that way leads to pain for you. That way leads to trouble and a mess for you. So I love you enough to not let you go that direction. I love you enough not to enable you to be that way. Well, God is that way too. And there's a moment of decision when God has to discipline us. There's a cross. Because we want to run away. He wants us to run to Him. See, when Adam and Eve and my wife and I were discussing this yesterday, and so many things we're never going to fully know in this life about, you know, bad things happening to people and stuff like that. And we had, you may have seen my Facebook. I love the story of the shack. I really do. I know that there's different feelings about that, different opinions about that. But we were talking about the book. I read the book years ago, saw the movie, and I love the story. I really do love the story. And, you know, it tries to answer some questions that are very tough questions. And it does, I think, a pretty good job of it. That's just my opinion, and you guys can decide for yourselves. At least give it a shot before you make a decision, though, is my only advice about that. But all that's free. All that I'm throwing in free of charge. But it kind of provoked this conversation that we were having, you know. And here's what I kind of envision, and we could spend many, many Sundays discussing this, but in a nutshell, you know, the more authority you have, the more are affected by your mistakes. The more authority you have, the greater your platform that God has given you, the more people that are affected by your mistakes. You know, if Dan makes a mistake, runs off and leaves Karen, first of all, she's going to get him. We're all going to help her. But it affects everyone in this room because, you know, we're under the authority that God's placed on his life in this church. Well, Adam and Eve had the commission to be the parents of this entire race. So when they made the decision to bring sin and death into the world and the pain that came with it, we've all been affected by that. And I almost can kind of, in my mind, just envision, you know, here you have Adam and Eve, they've made this decision, and you have the whole generations and generations to come, and that death just gets sprinkled all through it. And it lands over here, lands over there, lands over here. And that may be a simplistic, maybe a totally wrong way of looking at it, but I can see that happening because of the decision that they made. But see, we also, I believe, we inherited that sin, that nature to want to sin, but also nature to want to run away whenever we get caught. When God comes and says, okay, what happened here? We want to run away. Well, it was that woman you gave me. Well, it was that snake you allowed to come in the garden. It was your fault the whole time. It was her fault the whole time. And we start shifting the blame and blaming somebody else and running away, trying to hide things in our own strength, making, you know, fig leaf clothing. And God says, that's not going to work. Only I can fix this for you. So I'm trying to, and I believe he wants us to do this, to be successful in our walk with him, which is a part of being successful in general. That place of wanting to run and hide, we got to say no to. We've got to say no to that, and we've got to be completely open and vulnerable with the Lord. You're like, well, of course we are. He knows everything. He does know everything, and we still try to hide from him. How silly is that? He knows exactly what happened. But his love is so great that he can know exactly what happened and still not come at us out of anger. His love is so great, he can know exactly what happened, exactly what we did, the mess that we made, and he still comes for us because he loves us. He comes for us because he wants to help us. He comes for us because he wants to console us. He wants to say, okay, here is how I can help you. Here is what you can take away from this. Here's what you can learn. This is the right way to go. Well, we can't hear that if we're running away. So what I believe the Lord wants to do this morning, I just want to pray for us real quickly, and then I'll give it to Dan, is two things. Number one, there's an aspect of yielding where we have to lay down what we want for ourselves. And not everybody this morning is probably standing at that place. There's probably some, though, that specifically are. And I want to pray for you that God will give us the grace to lay those things down. That's one side of this. The other side of this is, I believe God wants to change our thinking about him. When he came in the garden looking for them, I don't believe he's coming angry. In your life right now, in spite of the mess you may have made for yourself, he's not coming at you from a place of anger. He's not coming to get us. He's not coming to hurt us. Even though the Bible says this one's not fun for the moment, he's coming because he loves us. He's coming because he has our best at heart. He wants to see us succeed. He wants to have that relationship with us. And he doesn't want us running and hiding and interfering with that. So I believe he wants us this morning, any of us that are at that place of wanting to run, maybe we've been running, he wants to say, that's not why I'm chasing you. I'm not chasing you to hurt you more. I'm chasing you to pick you up, clean you up, and dust you off and help you do it again.